If you are unconscious in about certain things that ought to be conscious, then you are dissociated. Yeah. And then you are a man whose left hand never knows what the right is doing and counteracts or interferes with the right hand. Now, such a man is hampered all over the place. Yeah. But to take a singer,
yes,
who is absolutely controlling his voice, suddenly he can't sing. Or any other, for take a man who writes fluently, suddenly he makes a ridiculous mistake. But there, his habit doesn't function. It may be, you know, that what the unconscious has to say is so disagreeable that one prefers not to listen. And in most cases, people would be probably less neurotic if they could admit the things. You know, these things are always a bit difficult or disagreeable or inconvenient or something of the sort. So there is always a certain amount of repression. When in treatment, for instance, in the treatment of neurosis, you have to do with that personal unconscious for quite a while. And then only dreams come that show that the collective unconscious is touched upon. Yes. Now, as long as there is material for personal nature, you have to deal with the personal unconscious. But when you get to, say, to a question, to a problem, which is no more merely personal, but also collective, you get collective dreams. There are cases who know just as much about their own neurosis as I know about it, in a way. In such cases, I can start right away with posing the problem. For instance, there is a case, a professor of philosophy, and he imagines that he has cancer. He shows me several dozen X-ray plates that prove that there is no cancer. And he says, of course I have no cancer, but nevertheless, I'm afraid I could have one. You see, I have consulted so many surgeons and they all assure me there is none, and I know there is none, but I might have one, you see, and that's enough. Now, you see, such a case can stop from one moment to the other. He simply stops thinking such a foolish thing, you see. But that is exactly what he can't do. You know it is nonsense, and why should you think it? Or what for should you think it? Well, and what is that power that makes you think such a thing? It's like a possession, you know. Exactly. It's like a demon in him that makes him think like that, in spite of the fact that he doesn't want it. You see, then we have the problem. That is the problem for an intellectual man. And then I say, now, you see, you don't know, you have no answer. I have no answer. Now what are we going to do? I say, now we must see what you dream, because the dream is a manifestation of the unconscious side. Right. Now you never have heard of the unconscious side. So I must explain to him that he has an unconscious, and that the dream is a manifestation of it, and if we succeed in analyzing the dream, we might get an idea about that power that makes him think like that. You see? So in such a case, one can begin right away with the analysis of dreams. And in all cases that are a bit serious, mind you, this is not a simple case, this is a very serious and difficult case. In spite of the simplicity of the phenomenology, of the symptomatology. In all cases, after the preliminaries, as it were, history of the family, the the alcohol, medical anamnesis, etc. We come to that question. What is it in your unconscious that makes you wrong, that hinders you to think normally? And then we are there where we can begin with the observation of the unconscious. And then day by day, one goes on by the data the unconscious produces. You see, we discuss the dream, and that gives a new surface to the whole problem. And he will have another dream, and the next dream gives again an answer, because the unconscious is in a compensatory relation to consciousness. And after a while, we get the full picture. And if he has the full picture and has the necessary moral stamina, well, then he can be cured. But in the end, it is a moral question whether a man applies what he had learned or not.